how to deal with people who don't understand. In making the decision to simplify your life, you run the risk of going against the American standard of success. Friends and associates who still look to Madison Avenue and the media to define what success is for them may well find your desire for a simpler life tantamount to heresy. They'll think you've gone soft, that you don't have what it takes to succeed in the real world. Sometimes, although they wouldn't admit it, they see your new lifestyle as a threat to their own. The reactions you receive can range anywhere from friendly teasing to well-intentioned advice about hanging in there to outright ostracism. And you may go through your own period of confusion. If you've spent your life allowing your professional persona to define who you are, you may find it's a real challenge to let go of that identity. Explain to friends your plan to create a life outside the narrow confines of what passes for success in the world, but don't be surprised if they don't immediately join you in your quest. It takes courage to buck the tide, but once you experience the freedom that comes from actively creating your own interpretation of success, you'll find it easy to move on from people who haven't yet figured out that having it all or spending long hours at an unsatisfying job will never define who they truly are. Find a happy medium that works for you. One of the things I did in our simplification program was to get rid of the houseplants. Our cat, Speed, named after a strong female character from one of Gibbs's novels, was a strong female cat who got into the habit of eating the leaves of the plants. Then she'd throw up on the carpet. It came down to deciding whether to get rid of the plants or the cat. We decided the houseplants would have to go. It was only after I'd passed my plants on to friends that I saw how much effort they'd been. But eventually I realized that I missed having them. I also realized that one of the reasons they'd been such a complication was that I'd had far too many of them. A while back, a friend gave me a beautiful Phalaenopsis orchid, and I found, to my delight, that this is one plant that Speed won't touch. Orchids are low-maintenance plants that never drop their leaves and have an exquisite bloom that lasts for months. So now I have a couple of gorgeous orchids that I enjoy immensely. Not only are they beautiful, they're simple. So in getting rid of all of the plants, I'd kind of gotten carried away. But having one or two beautiful plants adds a lot to my life, and I've come back to a happy medium for me. You may have to take some drastic steps in the early stages of simplifying your life, such as cutting out the newspapers, eliminating some routine household chores, or temporarily dropping social activities. Then, as you achieve a certain level of comfort and ease, you may decide to go back to some of your previous practices, or you may find that by doing them differently, they may contribute to your life in their new incarnation. Getting rid of stuff. Where to start? If you're ready to begin unloading the stuff that's been cluttering up your life, start with the easy stuff. Take linens, for example. Has there ever been a linen closet that wasn't chock full of well-worn, mismatched sheets that will never be used again? Or sheets that may be in perfectly good shape, but that fit the bed you gave away 3 years ago? Or stacks of bath towels and washcloths that don't match your current color scheme and you'll never again hang on a towel rack? What about the tablecloths and napkin sets that you haven't used in years because you can't bear the thought of ironing them? You know you'll never use that stuff again. Pass it on to someone who can. The kitchen is often another good place to begin. Start with the very top shelves in the kitchen cabinets. Get rid of everything that is covered with a thin coating of grime. It's a safe bet you haven't used it in a while and probably never will again. Pull out all the so-called convenience items, such as the bread makers, plate warmers, and the pasta machines you've only used once in 5 years, and pass them along to someone who might like to have them. They won't use those things more than once or twice either, but at least they won't be sitting on your shelves collecting dust. Look at any other areas in your home where it would be easy for you to go in and clear out, under the sinks or the shelves in the laundry room or the inner depths of the basement, perhaps the front hall closet, and start tossing. This sounds so obvious, but often people feel trapped by the things they're afraid to let go of or that they know will be difficult for them to deal with, so they never get started at all. But if you get going with the easy stuff and you see how good it feels to be free of it, it's so much easier to go on to the harder stuff. Once you're in the decluttering mode, use the momentum you've generated on the easy things to propel you to discard the hard stuff. As reader Nancy Hawkins wrote, "After buying and trying to follow books about how to be organized, I was thrilled to realize that I needed to simplify and get rid of the clutter, not just rearrange piles of stuff in a new way." It's so true. If you just get rid of the clutter, you never have to organize it. It doesn't necessarily mean getting rid of everything. Invariably, when I talk to groups about simplifying and the issue of clutter comes up, someone will say something like, "I've got this stash of medals from when I was an Olympic swimmer. I never even look at them anymore, but I can't bear to throw them out. What do you suggest?" My answer is simple. If you can't bear to throw them out, then don't. Getting rid of the clutter is not about letting go of the things that are meaningful to you. It's about letting go of the things that no longer contribute to your life so that you have time and energy and space for the things that do. Gibbs and I both love books. When we first started clearing out stuff, we had no intention of thinning out our collection of books. They meant too much to us. But once we'd gotten rid of a driveway full of stuff we weren't using anymore and experienced the tremendous feeling of liberation, we decided to rethink our position on the books. We sold some books to a local used bookshop. Others we donated to our public library, but we still have a lot of books we don't plan to get rid of. After all, one of the reasons we simplified our lives was so we'd have time to do the reading we want to do. Keep in mind that our identities are often connected to our stuff. When we start unloading it, it feels like we're giving away part of ourselves. But unloading some of it can also help us to move into the self we want to be. Be aware of holding on to things that you might need someday. It's so easy to do this. You come across some seemingly fabulous thing you have no earthly use for, but you think, "Gosh, I never know when I might need this, whatever it is," and you put it on the back shelf somewhere, along with all the other things you never know if you might need. But often these are things you have to keep clean or insure. If nothing else, you have to provide that back shelf for them. And so at some level, they are impinging on your life. In the 5 years since Gibbs and I finally got rid of a lot of the stuff we thought we might need someday, there hasn't been a single thing we wished we'd held on to. Well, there was an old pair of cowboy boots I finally got rid of after they sat in my closet for some time. I was afraid they were housing a black widow spider and didn't want to put my hand in there to find out. Later, I kind of wished I'd saved them. But when I remember them accurately, I know the reason I hadn't used them for so long was that they were completely worn out. So if you ever find yourself tempted to put something on the back shelf because you think you might need it someday, remember that replacing it is probably easier than maintaining the space required to store it. And if you ever find yourself wishing you'd held on to something, it's seldom as wonderful or as suitable for your needs as you remember it. One knife, one fork, one spoon. Reader Grace Samus described what I found to be a great simplifier. She wrote, "I'm working on having only two items more of things than people who live in the house. For example, if there are four people in the household, keep only six plates, glasses, knives, forks, spoons, towels, and so forth." I love this idea. It gives you a perfect goal to work toward in the process of decluttering. Once you set a limit, there's no guessing involved, no wondering if I need this or that. It's just two more things than people, and everything beyond that goes out. And it not only frees up more space in the household, it makes it so much easier to keep track of things. No more digging around in closets or the top shelf of the pantry because I think there might be something useful there. Now I know what's there, and it's only two more than what I use every day. Obviously, if you entertain a lot, this wouldn't work. Unless you were open to the idea of keeping disposable plates and utensils on hand. Or you could go for a variation on the potluck meal and ask people to bring their own plates and cutlery. Never touch a piece of mail more than once. I'd heard about this approach to the seemingly endless torrent of paper that flows across our desks and through our lives, but after hearing over and over again from readers of Simplify Your Life that handling it once was a major simplifier, I decided to try it. Now I set aside an hour at the end of my workday to read the mail and deal with the stream of paper that comes through the door. Most days it takes only a few moments to sort through the mail, send off a postcard response as needed, read any pertinent articles or newsletters, file anything I might need later and toss out what I don't need to keep. The better I get at making decisions on the spot as to what to keep, the more I can toss into the recycling bin, and the less stuff I have to file. I also found it doesn't work to think, I can't read this article now or make that decision at this moment and set it aside for later. When I do that, I'm soon right back where I started, inundated with paperwork. We have to decide at some point in time what to do with it. I've learned that it's better to decide now. It's so liberating not to have stacks of paper weighing down the edges of my desk and the corners of my mind. Now the mail is all taken care of in at most an hour each day. If it takes more than an hour to deal with a particular item, then I'll set it aside for the next afternoon. Though now that I've reduced the volume of mail and have increased my ability to decide right now how to deal with something, I seldom have to deal with it later. Learning to handle it only once ranks high on the list of steps I've taken to keep clutter to a minimum. This also applies to magazines and newspapers. I've heard from many people who simplify their lives by reading the morning paper as soon as it arrives, then passing it on to a friend or a neighbor or taking it into the office to share with a coworker. Not only does this practice reduce the clutter that otherwise often stays in your life, but it reduces the expense of newspaper and magazine subscriptions. As with many aspects of simplifying, it has some positive effects on the environment as well. If everyone did it, we could drastically reduce the amount of paper that has to be produced for these products, and ultimately cut back on the volume of paper that has to be recycled each day. Junk mail update. Gibbs and I cut back on the amount of junk mail that comes into our home by writing to the Mail Preference Service, Post Office Box 9008, Farmingdale, New York, 22735-9008, and requesting that our name not be sold to any mailing list companies. My friend Donna wrote from Chicago, I cut my mail to just a neat handful a day by applying the techniques in the booklet Stop Junk Mail Forever by Mark Isenson. I ordered this booklet, and in my opinion, it's worth its weight in gold. It lists roughly 18 steps you can take to stop junk mail forever. It's available from Good Advice Press, Elizaville, New York, 12523, for $3. It took me less than an hour to send postcards to the organizations listed to request that our names be removed from all the junk mail lists. It's made an incredible difference in the amount of mail I have to deal with each day, and it has also greatly reduced the number of temptations we're exposed to in the form of glossy four-color catalogs filled with stuff no one really needs. Don't even think about saving that piece of aluminum foil. We've all heard about the little old lady who passed on, leaving her heirs a ball of string the size of a Buick or a mountain-high stack of newspapers. Maybe you have an accumulation of similarly useless items sequestered away somewhere. If you do, you may be ahead of the game. With an ample supply of such superfluous material, you'll never have to save another piece of string or a thumbtack with a bend on the pointy end. For years, my downfall was used 8.5 by 11 inch envelopes. Being married to a writer and editor who is constantly receiving manuscripts in the mail, I had a prodigious and never-ending supply of used large manila envelopes. I eliminated all but a dozen of them, and whenever the mail carrier delivers another one, I repeat to myself, slowly and with great feeling, don't even think about saving this envelope. By using this mantra, I now have merely a dozen used manila envelopes I'll never use, rather than hundreds. Well, nobody's perfect. You might find it helpful to come up with a similar mantra for the times you're tempted to squirrel away any of the items you tend to stockpile. Things like used plastic wrap, newspaper articles you'd like to read, if only you could remember what relevance they had to your life, extensions of pipe that won't work for any plumbing repair job you'll ever attempt in this lifetime, bits of fabric you'll never turn into quilts, twist ties past their prime, the small pad of address labels printed with your former address, business cards from a company you haven't worked for in 5 years, keys whose provenance is unknown, bald emery boards, broken sunglasses, ID tags for the previous dog, and that plastic doohickey that used to fit something, though you haven't a clue what. You won't remember what it used to fit until you throw it out. If you ever could retrieve it, you'd find that it didn't fit where you thought it did anyway. Next time you find yourself standing in front of the drawer in which you're planning to tuck away a bit of thrice-used foil too small to keep, let yourself go and throw it out. Get some help. I hear from people all the time who, once they saw how much it would simplify their lives to get rid of the clutter, jumped right in and started throwing stuff out. But many can use some hand-holding through this process. If you need some help, get it. Ask a family member, one of your simplicity buddies, or a friend who knows you well to help you. You want someone who has the strength of character to overlook your whines and half-hearted entreaties when you want to hold on to 30 years of National Geographic magazines and throws them out anyway, but who has the heart to let you keep your high school yearbooks. Pick your starting point, the attic, the closets, or wherever. If you really want to be brave, take a deep breath and let them make the decisions about what to get rid of. Establish some parameters ahead of time. They can throw out anything that was made prior to 1990. They can get rid of the clothes, but they can't touch the books. If you don't trust your friends or family in this sometimes delicate task, another alternative is to hire a personal organizer to help you. If you can't locate one in the Yellow Pages, contact the National Association of Professional Organizers, area code 512-206-0151, to see if they can refer you to a professional organizer in your area. Changing our consumer habits. The 30-day list. Now that we've addressed ways to get rid of some of your stuff, let's talk about what you can do to keep the clutter from piling up again. Have you ever found yourself wandering through a department store and coming across something you felt you just had to have? It's entirely possible that, until you saw it on display, you didn't even know it existed. But now that you've seen it, you want it, and you want it now. So you buy it. Eventually, you come across this thing lying around the house somewhere, and you wonder why on earth you ever bought this thing to begin with. Invariably, it ends up on that back shelf. This scenario is played out over and over again in the lives of millions of people every day. Why? Because advertisers spend billions of dollars each year training us to react this way. After Gibbs and I got rid of a lot of the clutter and moved to our smaller place, we noticed that we were buying stuff to fill it up again. We realized we were going to have to change our buying patterns. So we decided to set up a 30-day list. If we came across an item we thought we wanted, we'd put it on this list before we'd rush out and buy it. At the end of 30 days, if we could remember what it was for, we might consider acquiring it. Or we could extend the date for another 30 days. More often than not, at the end of the first 30 days, we couldn't remember why we wanted this thing in the first place. You might consider using a similar system to keep yourself from rushing out to buy the next thing you think you want. Not only will it save you money, it will greatly reduce the amount of stuff you eventually have to get rid of. Watch for the early warning signs. Another thing we found helpful was to become aware of the early warning signs of a potential buying transaction. There were at least two major signals we could learn to recognize and do something about. First, there are the physiological signs. You unexpectedly come across something you think you'd like to buy. Your pulse starts to quicken. You feel a rush of adrenaline. Part of you wants to hold back. Another part of you is reaching for your credit card. Then come the psychological rationalizations. You hear yourself listing all the reasons you should have this thing. You need it. You deserve it. You've earned it. It's on sale. It's only $100. Your whole psyche is itching for this thing. The itch is a critical juncture. Once you start to scratch it, it's all over. This is where you train yourself to pull out your 30-day list. Keep it wrapped around your credit card or in your check register. Immediately write down the date and the name of the item on your 30-day list. Then turn around and leave the store post-haste. You'll be amazed at how just being aware of the warning signs will simplify your life. Come up with a creative solution rather than a buying solution. One of the first pieces of gear we unloaded was our Exercycle. We had purchased it a number of years before, second-hand, though barely used. a big, beautiful, shiny, monolithic testament to consumer gullibility. I wrote it perhaps half a dozen times. Then it sat in the corner of our bedroom, collecting dust, making me feel guilty every time I walked by it. Recently, after 5 exercise, equipment-free years of walking along the beach every morning, we started thinking that we might be able to meet our exercise needs more effectively with a different shiny, monolithic testament to consumer gullibility, a treadmill. Our puppies provided our excuse. Over the past year, our walks had gradually regressed into doggy strolls with frequent pauses while dogs do what dogs really prefer to do on walks, sniff. Gradually, we lost the aerobic and calorie-burning benefits of our daily walks. So we started thinking about an alternative approach. We came across a series of ads for a treadmill that seemed to address our very problem. The seduction had begun. Well, thanks to our 30-day list and the fact that we'd become aware of the changes in our vital signs, we stopped ourselves in the nick of time. Our solution, after resisting the urge to acquire the treadmill, was simple and obvious. We stroll once around the half-mile length of the park with the dogs, then we take them back to the car. We increase our speed to a brisk pace and walk several more times around the park for our aerobic exercise. It's so simple, but I'm embarrassed to confess how close we came to capitulating to a complicated and ultimately ineffective buying solution. Take the time to come up with other solutions to your next perceived buying need, or at the very least, wait for a few days to let the immediate gratification impulse lose its hold on you. It's so easy to end up with an expensive piece of machinery that does nothing more than sit idly collecting dust while cluttering up our lives. Recognize the point of diminishing returns. When we were deciding what to get rid of, our stereo and record collection were high on the list. Even though we had invested a fair amount of money in our stereo system, and even though we'd enjoyed having it, we realized that since we'd acquired our VCR, we seldom listened to the stereo anymore. The reality is that we can't watch videos and listen to records or tapes at the same time. And we'd reached the point in our lives where if we're not watching old movies, we prefer just a quiet evening of reading. Most households now have one or more television sets, one or more radios, half a dozen tape players, a video camera, a VCR, a stereo system, a CD player, several Walkmans, and a dozen computer games that fill up the space and the time that used to be taken up by a single household radio. Isn't it ironic that we're acquiring more and more goods but have less and less time to spend with them? But even if we had the leisure time that our parents or our grandparents had, there is a point of diminishing returns. Keep this in mind the next time you're considering the acquisition of one or more items that will take up time and space in your life. When you bring in something new, throw out something old. I got this idea from readers. It's such a basic concept. It's so simple, and it works. Well, it's not always so easy to do, but it'll definitely help you keep the clutter to manageable limits. It applies to clothes, books, toys, tools, kitchen gadgets, computers, eyeglasses, and linens, among other things. Our space is sometimes deceptive. Most bookcases can hold another book. Most closets can hold another outfit. Most kitchen pantries can hold another toaster oven. Most toy boxes can hold another Barbie doll, and so forth. But if we'd started way back when, throwing out the old when we brought in the new, we wouldn't have tool chests so jammed we can never find a screwdriver, or lingerie drawers so crammed we can never find a decent pair of knee socks, or linen closets so full of everything else that we can't open the door without having half the contents come tumbling down around our ankles. It's often difficult to predict ahead of time the point at which there's too much stuff for any given space, but if you get into the habit of throwing out the old when you bring in the new, you won't have to predict. You can simply enjoy the freedom of uncluttered spaces. What to tell the grandkids? Recently, a woman told me all the steps she and her husband had taken to simplify their lives, which included paring down their possessions and setting out in their motorhome for a couple of years to see the country. Her problem was what to tell the grandchildren when they asked what she and Grandpa wanted for Christmas or birthdays or as going-away mementos. Being supportive grandparents, they didn't want to discourage their grandchildren's creative endeavors, but they were so delighted to have reached a point where they were free of time and energy-consuming possessions. They had exactly what they wanted, and they didn't have room in their scaled-back lifestyle to accommodate a lot of tchotchkes, no matter how imaginative the object or well-intentioned the thought behind it. The answer seemed so obvious to me. Ask for a box of homemade fudge or a basket of Christmas cookies or any other consumable items within the range of the kids' talents and their parents' patience. A gift of this type encourages thoughtful and resource-conscious gift-giving on the part of the children, while providing the grandparents with a sweet reminder of the gift-bearer. The gift would be short-lived, only as long as it takes to consume a box of brownies, but the memory of it could last forever. Remember how delicious Sarah's gingerbread men tasted that evening as we watched the sunset over the Grand Canyon? It wouldn't put a strain on their space limitations, nor would it be one more thing to discard into our overloaded ecosystem. Also, it would be an excellent opportunity to propose to their children and grandchildren that the time has come in all our lives to think about scaling back on purchasing and consuming habits. Gift-giving doesn't have to mean going to a store to purchase some item that the other person may or may not want and may or may not have space for. A lovingly crafted card or the joy of quiet time spent together can add far more meaning to our lives than a bagatelle plucked off the consumer merry-go-round. What better way to teach succeeding generations how little we need to be happy? And what better legacy to leave our kids than a new consumer ethic? Put a moratorium on shopping. When Gibbs and I looked at the process we'd gone through to eliminate the stuff we no longer wanted, we saw that we'd made some wise choices. We had minimized our stuff, and there wasn't much else we needed or wanted to acquire. Even so, we found ourselves falling into some of our old buying patterns. Since we'd had success with our 30-day list, we decided to take that idea a step further. As an experiment, we put a moratorium on shopping for 3 months. This was not about living in austerity or depriving ourselves of the things we need, but about changing our consumer mentality. When you look at the buying habits that have taken hold in our culture over the past 30 years or so, you can see that we made the decision somewhere along the line to work longer hours so we could acquire more things. We've exchanged our leisure time for stuff. A lot of us are starting to question that exchange. It hasn't been a good trade-off. Not for us, not for our children, and certainly not for the environment. I urge you to try this moratorium. You'll see how little we really need and how easy it is to get along without most of the things we feel we have to have. Learning to say no. The truly free person. Playwright Jules Renard once said that the truly free person is one who can turn down an invitation to dinner without giving an excuse. The social pressure to automatically say yes to invitations is a challenging one to overcome. There are so many considerations, and they're all mixed in together. At one level, we're afraid the other person will feel rejected. At another level, we're afraid that if we start saying no, people will reject us. And even though we may not want to go, there's frequently a part of us that wants to be included. More often than not, our true desire to not accept an invitation has less to do with the invitation we'd like to decline and more to do with our need or desire to do something else, such as spend time with our kids or a quiet evening with our partner. But for many of us, it seems easier to spend an evening with people we'd rather not have dinner with than it is to put up with the guilt or the discomfort we'd feel if we turned down the invitation. And often, we feel we should do these things, when in fact, we really don't have to. Getting to the point where we can tell the difference is a major milestone in the simplification process. Remember, your objective is getting to the point where you can see that by turning down an invitation, you're not saying no to someone else. Rather, you're saying yes to what you really want to do. One way to deal with the guilt of saying no. One woman who attended a talk I gave suggested the following solution to the guilt that often accompanies our desire to say no. She decided she needed a breather from all the invitations she received, so she stopped issuing and accepting social invitations entirely for 6 months. She said that what made it so easy and eliminated the guilt was that she said no to everyone, no exceptions. This freed up a lot of her time, which she used to evaluate where she was in her life. By stopping everything, she had a chance to see that she was ready to make some career changes. Your desire to reduce the number of social activities in your life may have nothing to do with a career move, but you can still use her tactic. Simply decline any and all invitations for a month or two. The time you free up could provide a lot of clarity and direction for your life. Move beyond the guilt. Like many people, I used to have a problem with the guilt of saying no, and sometimes I still do. But my friend Sue is much more realistic about dealing with invitations. She points out that the one who's doing the asking might like you to join them, but if you don't accept, it won't be the end of the world for them. Someone else will accept, or they'll make other plans, so it's no big deal. The one who gets declined moves on, and they don't think a whole lot about it. In truth, they're too busy getting on with their life or tracking down the next person on their list to hold your no against you. But certainly any momentary flash of regret a host might feel because someone declines is seldom worth the paroxysms of guilt felt by the one who's declining. After all, when someone turns you down, you don't rush to the nearest cliff and leap off. No, you move on, though you probably say things like, "You're so sorry they can't join you, you'll miss them, and maybe next time," and usually you mean it, but you probably don't think enough about it to justify the guilt they might feel by saying no to you. Also, keep in mind that you're not doing anyone a favor by showing up for a dinner party or any other type of gathering when your heart isn't in it. You'd be doing the host and everyone else a much greater service by staying home and freeing up the space for someone who'd love to be there.